and gentlemen, distinguished guests. I'm Professor David Allen, Dean of the Faculty of Business, Economics, and Law, and it gives me great pleasure to welcome you all here this evening. On occasions such as tonight, we have opportunity to reflect on the impact of our academic endeavors. Tonight, we welcome Dr. Jim O'Neill back to the University of Surrey and to the School of Economics, from where he gained his PhD in 1982. Since then, Jim has gone on to become a leading player in the development of our understanding of emerging economies and the part that they play in the balance of economic power across the globe. Jim, as you all know, is the creator of the acronym BRICS, and together with colleagues has published substantial research about the emergence of Brazil, Russia, India, and China, including his best-selling The Growth Map. His work has influenced policy and decision makers and helped to shape our economic future. Jim is now currently chairman of Goldman Sachs Asset Management, and in this role helps to guide Goldman Sachs business around the world. This evening, he will be setting out for us how his thinking on the BRIC concept is developing and will give us his insights into what our global economy may look like in the future. Now, small order, I realize. We hope he'll have the opportunity here tonight as well to inspire a new generation of economic thinkers and encourage their endeavors with his support. It is with great pleasure that I introduce Jim O'Neill and hand the lectern over to him now.
Good evening, David. Thank you very much for those kind remarks. It is quite poignant for me coming back to Surrey, because not only was this place daft enough to give me a PhD, I actually met what is now my wife some, let me get my years right, getting on for close to 30 years later here. So you guys have got a lot to answer for. I was listening carefully to your kind comments there, and for a moment I thought I heard you say, together with his colleagues, has published a lot of substantive research, but you did say substantial, didn't you? So, plenty of stuff. Whether its quality is any better than the stuff that I did when I was given a PhD in 1982, I will not judge. But anyhow, it's very nice to be here. Against the background of what David said, what I thought I would do, because there are just so many things going on, of course, a very interesting week is coming towards an end in the context of British economic policy, with this rather imaginative decision to make the next Bank of England governor a non-British person, a sort of a Capello of economic policy making. I'm going to try and reflect on a few things during my, I guess, 45 minutes or so, and then leave time for questions. So I'm going to sort of spend the body of it, and it'll be a reoccurring thing of how I believe the world is evolving, and in my opinion, in such a degree and scale and speed that it's still so poorly understood by many people, including lots of our policymakers here in the West, to some extent it's partly understandable because the scale and degree of change that's going on is quite dramatic, and at times I'm not entirely sure that I fully understand it either. And in fact, I should add, in saying that, one of the things I did learn doing my PhD here is that economics is a social science, it's not a science, therefore it's not entirely unjustified that people might not fully understand all these things, because there's a lot of things about economics which are not as known as many commentators and practitioners claim, in my opinion and from my experience. But against that background, I thought I would also trot around the world and talk about a couple of three or four different regions or places. So obviously, within the core of the BRIC thing, I'll spend quite a bit of time about China. In my judgment, what goes on in that place these days is probably more important than any other national economy in the world, and especially in the context of an establishment like this. In terms of education, it's I know from talking to David in the past, it's something that you see very powerful evidence of as being interesting and important here. And in my judgment, for the UK trying to get out of its own severe challenges and problems of the past few years, thinking more and more about, let's call it, education exports, is something that we probably do have a bit of an advantage that others can't compete with so easily, especially as it relates to China. So I'll spend a bit of time on that. Given that the financial markets and the media are very focused on the so-called fiscal cliff in the US, even though it doesn't qualify as a brick, I shall say a couple of things about that probably. And of course, you can't go to any event without spending at least some time about Greece and Spain and the general nonsense that's known as the European crisis. So I will talk a bit about that, and then I'll finish off saying a few things perhaps about the UK. And I will throw in something for the memory of my PhD about oil prices and energy by offering a comment about what's going on in the world of oil prices too. And those that helped prepare this evening, you'll be pleased to know that of the 4 million slides that I sent you in advance, I'm only planning to show about 20 odd of them, and I'll use some of them, the others, to possibly help answer questions. So, to sort of understand my way of thinking about the world and link to my opening point, which I say will be a reoccurring theme, this is sort of how I try to think about the world. And in my, I still call it new life, I've had a real job as opposed to just being an economist for now 2 years. And I sort of try to infiltrate this concept across everything we do at Goldman Sachs Asset Management and for our clients. So those eight countries you see in the yellow pie chart, the four BRIC countries, Brazil, Russia, India and China, and what I call four of the so-called next 11, and I'll explain that a bit more in a second, that middle group. Those eight countries, in my opinion, are now sufficiently large to be at least treated as a semi-adult and not thought of as traditional emerging markets, even though they have, in most cases, I'd say Korea is an exception to this, and I'll talk about that again a bit as well. They all have, except for Korea perhaps, many aspects, obviously, of emerging economies. Because they are so big, their interaction with the rest of the world is very different than how we have all thought of, at least in my 30-odd years of being in business, of how one traditionally thinks of an emerging economy. And after lots of back and forth about how we would try and think of what differentiates those from the others, we came to the simple conclusion, rather reflective of the quality of my PhD, I have to add, 30 years ago, that easiest is best. And so we basically think any emerging economy that is at least 1% of global GDP should be treated as sort of semi-adults. And so we don't think of those eight as emerging markets in a traditional sense. And if you look at them collectively, taking it back to the left-hand pie chart, they are already 25% of global GDP, and that's not in purchasing power parity terms, that's in current dollars, which makes them collectively bigger than the US. So if things going on in these eight countries and the average of them result in them growing by more than the US, then their influence on the world is growing. And I'll show you a couple of pictures in a second that I think demonstrate that is indeed the case rather clearly. The middle group, the next 11, is something.
How many people? I'm just trying to. I always try to gauge this. Or should I assume everybody here had heard of the phrase BRIC before this evening? One of my greatest claims to fame is that on University Challenge last year, I was at a dinner, and my phone suddenly started going like balmy that I'd left on. I'm thinking, I was thinking, a United player tonight, my son's texting me about somebody who's scored or something. And it was all lots of my friends saying, you would not believe what's just been on University Challenge, where they actually, Bamber Gascoigne, I'll show my age. So I'll go out and start again then.
Paxman.
Jerry Paxman, how can anyone forget him? He said, who created the BRIC acronym? And I got a mention on University Challenge. But how many have heard of the N11, or come across the N11 idea before? So not few, not many of you. That's good to know, because it isn't... I sometimes sort of look around the social media and see some of the ridiculous things that have sort of become part of the acronym empire that's followed from the BRIC thing, and a lot of it is both stupid and embarrassing. Not least that these days I'm credited with creating supposedly a new acronym called MIST, which is the four of the next 11 countries that we've put into this growth market category. And it's the only acronym that I've managed to be identified for that has been created for me by the media, which is quite amusing, because it was actually dreamt up by somebody in the Korean media when they read the paper about us doing this. But the next 11 is literally, all that group is, and there's no great thinking in it at all, it is literally a list of the 11 largest populated emerging nations after the four BRIC countries. And back in 2004, when the BRIC thing was first starting to become influential in the business world, a lot of people would say to us, why those four countries? Why, you know, why not Turkey? Why not Indonesia? So being an obsessive football fan, I thought 11, that's how many you have in a football team. Why don't we look at the BRIC potential for the next 11 largest populated countries? And that's all that is. So jumping forward, I think this is the first of the pictures that demonstrate why it is so obvious one should be thinking of the world a bit differently than so many conventional Western-minded thinkers continue to do. I call this now my Prime Minister's chart, because I believe at the Conservative Party conference, David Cameron stole one of my phrases. Nor did he give me credit for it, but it allows me to make reference to it when I talk, so that's kind of cool. He said at the Tory Party conference, and linked to, and I'll come back to this a bit later in more serious tone, in the whole growing debate about Britain's relationship with the EU and all the rest of it, he said, after all, China creates another Greece every 3 months, which is indeed true. And it's something that I've been saying for the best part of a year, and he derives it from this. How many people here from Greece or Greek descendancy before I get too rude? Okay, a few. Oh dear, there's quite a few. I have to be very careful. Of course, I should have realised with this universe there'd be quite a few. So, what you see here is the level in dollars of GDP of Greece, Spain, Italy and China. And then the bottom three columns are literally the change in dollar terms of China, the four BRIC countries, and the eight growth market economies in 1 year, in 2011. And this goes back again to what I said at the start. So in 2011, the dollar value of China's GDP increased by $1.37 trillion, which translates, actually, is China creating the economic equivalent of another Greece every 12 and a half weeks. I don't know if any of you have ever had the dubious pleasure of meeting the rather, now in the media at least, the originator of the Goldman's God's work phrase, our own special Goldman Sachs is Woody Allen, Lloyd Blankfein. I don't
Now, if any of you ever met, had the dubious pleasure of meeting Lloyd, or I'm sure some of you may have seen him, he is a great human being, and amongst the reasons that he has a sense of humour which is as daft as Woody Allen's, which is why he gets himself into trouble occasionally, like the God's Work thing. But he was giving a speech at a big financials conference about 6 months ago, and I saw something come across the news whilst I was sitting in my office. Blankfein says China creates another Greece every 11 and a half weeks. So I sent him an email, said, Lloyd, you got it wrong, it's 12 and a half weeks. And of course, he emailed me back, said, no, he says, at the speed at which Greece is imploding. So, the day after I'd been told that Cameron had said this, I sent him another email, said, Cameron's got it on your app now as well. And, and as only Lloyd could say, he emailed me back straight away. He says, well, you better tell your friend David Cameron that if he's not careful at the way things are going, China's going to be creating another UK every 12 and a half weeks. In that spirit, if you spend it out to the whole of the group I'm talking about, actually last year, the four BRIC countries between them created another Italy in 1 year. And so going to my central theme of how difficult it is for us all to understand the scale of change, despite Italy's dilemmas, as I'm sure many of you know, Italy is still the eighth largest economy in the world, and yet these guys have said, well, we can make one of those in a year. And the eight growth market economies collectively actually did more than a UK in 1 year. And it is, I defy anybody to find any evidence in vague modern history of where economic data shows that kind of scale of change going on. And against that background, this is a picture of what we are assuming in terms of contributions to global GDP this decade. What it's trying to show is that in real terms, we are assuming that the growth 8 will contribute about $15 trillion to global GDP this decade. Half of which is China, which goes to my earlier opening points too. In fact, if you could see it and look closely at these numbers, the contribution of the growth 8 is more than double that of the US and Europe combined. So in the great macroeconomic debating things of our time, where literally this week is another perfect week for it, where every hour the markets are being swung all over the place, all over the world, about things to do with the fiscal cliff, and every other minute within the hour they're being swung all over the place by the Greek debt rescheduling. They are not really the most important issues for the world economy going forward, or indeed right now. It's whether China is managing its slowdown, which I'm going to come back to talk about, effectively, and is it going to be a happy soft landing, or is it going to be something worse? Against this background, is the number one topic of the world. All those that send me emails every other day, when am I going to drop the R in BRIC because we don't like Mr. Putin, that is fine, but if you could see this clearly, despite all Russia's considerable dilemmas and challenges, this decade there is a decent possibility that Russia will contribute more to the world economy in dollar terms than the whole of the Eurozone put together. So if people want to ignore and dismiss Russia because we don't like Putin, that's fine, but they need to understand that they're ignoring a pretty relevant economic influence on some things in the world. Translated into actual real GDP growth rates of what I just showed you is this. I'm sure many of you will be quite surprised to see this, and many people find it rather controversial. But it goes again right back to my opening points. I have not designed it this way, But by coincidence, I'm coming towards the end of my 31st year in the wonderful, wacky world of finance. All I ever wanted to do was get out of there for get out of here for a brief while to pay my debts off. Then I sort of thought about coming back, and 31 years later, I realised, well, nobody would have had me anyhow, and I'm still there. But there you go. But if you look at this here, you'll see that for the past three decades, the world economy has grown by about 3.4%. And it's the numbers I just showed you, if they happen this decade, contrary to the widespread presumption that the world can never be like it has been before because of the degree of problem we've all got, actually the world economy will grow by more than 4% this decade, if what I just showed you happens. And critically, to try and understand that, that's despite the fact that we are assuming China will grow by less than it's done for the past 30 years. And so there is awareness around that China might not be able to grow going forward as much as it's done, but that leads most people to the conclusion, oh my goodness me, on top of the fact that the US is falling apart and the Eurozone is never going to have any growth ever again in the history of mankind, we are in serious trouble. I think that is, as is often the case, both in financial markets and with our media, somewhat exaggerated. So that's the sort of simple background of it all. A couple of other things before I do my quick trot around the world. If what I just showed you in the previous two charts translates into reality, by 2020, this is a picture of what the share of global GDP will be like. And I show you this as well because there are profound consequences from this changing world, obviously, for many, many things to do with international governance, especially for economics, but obviously for probably many other things too. I could talk at great length about all of this, but the whole leadership and structure of the IMF and the World Bank and the role of the G20 and who's important in the G20 and so on, and actually the whole monetary system, that's all going to get changed by this. And 2020 is only obviously 8 years away. And the key thing to recognise is that sometime in the next few years, unless China really is in the process of a hard landing or is going to disappear away out of significance, sometime in the next probably 3 years, the BRIC countries will become bigger than the US, which will have big political consequences as to how they all interact within the G20, and will mean obviously a little, if not a lot, about who should be running places like the IMF and the World Bank. And this sort of somewhat cosy arrangements of life since those organisations were established, where the US always has the World Bank because Europe always has the IMF and vice versa, those days are very close to an end. And we're going to make that, along with many other things, very difficult from a global governance perspective. I'm going to spend a few moments on this picture and another one related to it before I do my trot around these various places I said. From my own experience, as well as the things that have influenced me most in terms of growth theory, so Robert Solow type academic thinking and other things that I've been most persuasive to me. Long-term economic growth is basically driven by two things. And in that sense, as somebody that's forecasted and managed forecasters for until 2 years ago, but most of my career, actually long-term growth forecasting is probably easier than short-term forecasting because it only depends on two things. It depends on the size of the working population and its productivity. And so in that context, when people express amazement and question about whether India or China can become as big as we've become famous for saying, actually the real answer is, well, they're going to have diabolical productivity in order to stop them becoming big because they've got more than 1 billion people. And those of you who are students of history will know, a few hundred years ago, they were 50% of world GDP anyhow. So in some ways, they are just rediscovering the beginnings of how the world share was at one stage anyhow. But the demographics are the relatively easy part, because it's not that they are, from my experience, necessarily that predictable. Interesting thing to mention in that regard, 11 years on from when I first sort of got in love with this kind of way of looking at the big picture. The consensus view of France's population by 2050 is already 10 million more than we were led to believe and were assuming 11 years ago, partly because of the large birth rate of second generation French people, but also interestingly because of some evidence that the French taxation system has been successfully incentivizing some changes that way. But relatively speaking, the demographics is the easy bit. It's the productivity part which is so hard. And we use something that we've called a growth environment score, and we've had it for many years, which is a simple index that can go from 0 to 10, which includes 18 different variables that we think are relevant for productivity and sustainable growth. 10 is the Manchester United of GES scores. 0 is the Liverpool. despite my supposed cultivation by travelling all over the world, I still hate Liverpool as much as I always did, so I apologise to any of you from Liverpool. It's the football team that I mean. So here you see we do this for about 180 countries, and how the growth environment score develops and changes influences about our assumptions of productivity rates going forward for the future. And you can see it here for these 15 countries, the BRIC and the N11. These 15 countries are about 2/3 of the world's population. And so if these numbers rise, indicative of improving things that relate to productivity, the world is going to be a better place, because that's 4 billion people. Linked to what I touched on about Korea earlier, of the 180 countries we do this for, South Korea is the fifth highest scoring country in the world, better than any G7 country. The top scorers are, surprise, surprise, Scandinavians and Luxembourg. And I found myself, particularly in the past couple of years, the more I've reflected on this and the more I've got to deal with Korea. In many ways, I find South Korea probably the most interesting, reasonably large populated economy in my lifetime. Because of this, but also it coincides with the facts, as I'm sure many of you here perhaps realize, but those of you who don't, I think it's important. South Korea today has a GDP per capita which is nearly the same as a G7 country. When I was first coming into this life, and even when I was first coming into finance, South Korea had a GDP per capita similar to African countries. So they are a perfect example, if not the absolute, the best example of how the world can change in a big way. And when I do meet policymakers from many of these other countries, I'm actually meeting some from Nigeria tomorrow, and they ask me what should they do. I said, well, get on a plane to Seoul in South Korea and figure out how they did it and copy them. And again, going back to my opening comment, quite how we all think of South Korea as a developing country is in many ways, frankly, an embarrassment. Here are the details of those GES scores. Oh, sorry, one other thing before I go to that. For all the people that send the emails about dropping the R in BRIC, Russia is not the weakest of the four countries. India is. In India, it's a good job that India's got fantastic demographics, because the story wouldn't be so great if they didn't. Flip side of saying the same thing is, if they don't do something about their productivity rate, the demographics are not going to be an advantage. It's going to be a disaster for them. Russia has got lots of problems, but if you look at all the 18 things that we would think relevant, Russia, and you won't be able to see these different things closely here, Russia on some of them, such as use of technology, is actually rather good. Yes, it is diabolical about corruption and governance, but they are not the only. They are very important things, but they're not the only important things that matter. I put on this picture, and again, I apologise because probably for much of you, you can't see it clearly. But I have the U.S. here as well, and you can see for South Korea, particularly these things towards the bottom on virtually all use of technology, South Korea leaves the United States very far behind in its wake. And that's one of the reasons why Korea has become so successful. Think of Samsung and its ability to be such an adaptive company in changing to the world in which we live. So, against that background, let me start doing my little flip round the world. I'll try to be quick, seeing that I've taken nearly half an hour. So I've got 15 minutes left. So to add to the complication, I'll start with China, and I'll show you four or five pictures about that. To add to the complication for us all trying to understand these dramatic changes that are going on, China itself is in the early stages, in my view, of pretty dramatic change also. And I would describe the new China as one that's focused on the quality of growth as opposed to the quantity. And I'm going to show you just a few pictures to try and explain aspects of this story, which I could spend hours on just this. Here's a picture of China's balance of payments. The red line is its current account. I'm assuming lots of you are au fait with all this weird economic terminology, so I apologize to any of you that may not, but I'll try to spell out more some of the things. So, the red line is China's current account surplus as a share of GDP. For those of you not skilled in the voodoo of economic terminology, that is regarded as a sign of how much China is stealing from the rest of us in terms of its growth. But importantly, by the time we get all the data for the rest of this year, China's current account surplus will be in the vicinity of 3% of GDP. It went into the global credit crisis with it around 10%. So 4 years on from that, China's current account surplus is much smaller. And I show you this because it is no longer true that the China that we were all dealing with before the crisis is the same as the one now, just for even in 4 years. Within the reasons why this slowed is obviously because there's trouble in some of their big markets like the Eurozone, but it is much more because of, in my judgment, a deliberate policy to boost wage growth, which is designed to support income growth in China. But one of the consequences is that China is increasingly losing its ability to be the cheap source of low value-added manufacturing. Mexico, in my opinion, is a huge winner of that shift. And one of the consequences is that. Secondly, linked to it is this peculiar chart. And I should say, from sort of another way of thinking of the decade that we have started, in my judgment, from sort of my 40,000 feet, is it's about the two biggest countries in the world, the US and China, shifting. So the US has got to be a bit less like the old US and a bit more like the old China. So consume less and produce more. And China's got to be quite a bit less than the old China and quite a bit more like the old US. So consume quite a bit more and produce quite a bit less. Against that sort of conceptual background, I monitor this chart, or I create this chart every month. The Chinese economic data is frequently released in some kind of mad moment of an hour with virtually every statistic all published at the same time. And analysts rush to look at the industrial production numbers as a better guide to what's going on with monthly GDP. And you will see lots of commentary in the media about what that number means for the growth rate. And I think it's a mistake myself, because what we should be really we want, as I've just said, I think in the West, China to produce less so that we can produce more for them to consume. And to try and monitor that, I follow the trend between retail sales spending, which is not a particularly great quality indicator, as issues with all sorts of data, not just in China, by the way, also here in the UK, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But I use that as a measure of monthly consumer spending relative to industrial production. And if the line is going upwards, that's a good sign, because it suggests China is adjusting to a world in which they are consuming more relative to what they are producing. And rather encouragingly, you can see that that is happening. China, however, and that's against the background, however, of definitely a slowing Chinese economy. What you see here, and here I must explain, it's one of a number of weird acronyms that David told me earlier that he was trying to figure out what the hell any of this was when he was looking at it beforehand. And this one you wouldn't have had a clue because it is proprietary Goldman stuff. So the yellow line is a Goldman Sachs proprietary GDP indicator that we developed back in the days of the Asian crisis. When the official Chinese data, despite the fact every country around it was falling apart, the official data appeared to claim that there was no consequence for China whatsoever. And we thought that was a bit weird. So we developed our own proprietary GDP indicator, and we've used it ever since. The red line is a leading indicator of the yellow line. And the line going down suggests China is slowing. The line going up suggests China is accelerating. And I think you can see pretty clearly there that China, in fact, has been slowing for the past couple of years. And according to a pure interpretation of that number or that data, China right now is growing somewhere between 6 and 8%. The last picture to show you about it, and again, I emphasize I could talk to you for hours about just China, is this one. This is a financial conditions index. FCI stands for Financial Conditions Index, which we use as a leading indicator of what I just showed you. And if you superimpose this on top of that, you would see that big changes in this lead, or appear to have led, big changes in that. And what is and the line going upwards here suggests tightening financial conditions in China, and the line going downwards suggests easing. And this is particularly important, in my opinion, to think about right now for two reasons. There is a growing school of thought, particularly encouraged by some famous hedge fund people in the States, that China is in the early stages of actually falling apart. And part of the dilemma and why it's so immediately appealing to many people who think that way is because, of course, they're a horrible bunch of communists and, of course, it can't work. What they fail to think about, even, and they could be true, of course, but what they fail to think about is things like this. And it is almost definitely the case, in my view, that the main reason why China has slowed the past 2 years is because the government has deliberately slowed the economy. Their concern, in contrast to ours, for the past few years, has been more about inflation, not the crisis that we all are so obsessed about over here still. And the second reason why I think it's really important, if you look closely, despite the fact the economy has slowed a lot, and despite the fact Chinese inflation appears to have slowed a lot, as of yet, they have not eased financial conditions much, which is quite intriguing and suggests to me, and I was just in China for a couple of days last week, along with being in Japan, suggests to me that the Chinese policymakers are very happy that the economy is slowed, and they do not want to juice it up again in the way they did in 2009, because they've entered a new era where it's all about the quality of growth and less so much the quantity, which for a number of things I'm guessing this university is more broadly involved in, linked to alternative energies, energy conservation, a lot of focus on creativity and innovation and garnering things to help a more sophisticated economy. That's what the China going forward is all about. But it's very difficult for us all to obviously understand. So that's a quick comment about Germany. 10 minutes to do the other three. That's the relative importance of them.
So first of all, with the US and this, I'll just show you two pictures perhaps. The first of which is this one. So there is great angst frequently expressed by commentators that the Federal Reserve Board is being so cavalier to get themselves out of this period of weak, seemingly never-ending weak growth. They will do anything, including now almost definitely creating future inflation to get us out of it. I don't think that is necessarily the case. This is a survey-based measure of inflation expectations that the University of Michigan conducts every month and has done for a long, long time. And in contrast to a lot of market-based surveys, this is particularly useful because it asks real human beings rather than a bunch of lunatics in finance. And it's a 5 to 10 year inflation expectation survey, and as you can see, it's actually very stable. So the Federal Reserve Board has a lot of credibility with the American population, even if it might not with lots of people in financial markets. And I think the Fed will continue with its general bias to policy until they get a dramatically stronger growth rate or they see evidence of inflation expectations rising sharply. Second thing that I thought I'd focus on, and then I'll say something about the fiscal cliff. At the core of why we have the mess that we are still suffering from, and what's really been at the heart of this remarkable crisis that has hit large parts of the Western world, is what happened in US housing markets. And the red line here shows you the relationship between house prices and personal income. And the yellow line is the mortgage rate. But the red line is the one that's the key to focus on. And in many ways, it's a very simple but pretty powerful explanation of everything that's happened to the US the past decade or so. Before the new millennium, even though lots of regional wild things, the US had a very stable relationship between house prices and personal income nationally. In fact, that line was as stable as it looks there for 30 years. And then the magical millennium clock ticked, and we started this, what we all now know in hindsight, insane bubble in US housing, which world policymakers have managed to basically turn it into some kind of blame of Goldman Sachs and the rest of the financial sector, and not wanted to take any responsibility for their own possibly misjudged thinking themselves. But my opinion, whilst many bubbles are indeed quite difficult to identify in advance, that one was pretty clear. The good story to it, now looking forward, is that prices have collapsed so much that actually for people who have a job in the US, housing is cheap. Because, as you can see, the line is below where it was at the start of the 90s. And so, particularly because of the form of QE that the Fed has chosen to adopt, particularly its latest one is to support the mortgage market, we think, our guess, and we believe this for 6 months in GSAM, we have a specific fund we launched linked to a housing recovery, we think the US housing market is on the way back. And if that is true, then that's actually a lot more important than anything that happens to the fiscal cliff. And the way I think about it, the fiscal cliff could indeed derail the US again if they really screw it up in Washington politically and it causes problems for this. But if it doesn't, some sort of recovery in the US will continue despite the fiscal cliff. On the cliff itself, frankly, your guess is as good as mine as to whether these guys will come to a deal. I had the dubious privilege of being in Washington for a day 5 weeks ago. The experience of going through Washington Dulles Airport suggested to me that this city is now dysfunctional, so I don't think one should have too high expectations. But they'll come to some kind of deal somehow. So, a couple of minutes. Well, I could spend a couple of decades talking to you about the rather bizarre mess known as European Monetary Union. And I'm going to start off with this picture.
Because again, also linking it back to my opening comments, the appearance of the BRICS and the growth market economies, where they are creating the equivalents of another Italy or a UK every year, not surprisingly, is transforming patterns of world trade as well. Here is a picture of German exports since 2007. And German exports to China are a bit like the rise of Manchester City Football Club, rather recent but big. In that case, that's annoying, and this isn't. And linked to it, here is a table that shows you, which again, I apologise to people at the back, you would not, I'm sure, be able to see this, but it shows you the share of German exports when EMU started in 2000, and again, year to date, and the third column shows you the change. And something I've just had my guys do in the past 2 weeks, and rather intriguingly and potentially very worryingly for all those manic EMU supporters, something very disturbing. Because if we carry on with the same pattern of trade in the next 8 years that we've had the past 12, we come to the following conclusion. That by 2020, Germany will have 25% of its exports to the BRIC countries, 15% of the total will be to China, nearly double the amount it exports to France. And I'm sure many of you who followed the theory of all this stuff, the strongest arguments as to why EMU was created, if there were economic grounds, was that the amount of trade that the European countries did with each other was so big, if you removed all the barriers, including the currency, that would result in such welfare and economic gains, we'd have this beautiful nirvana in Europe forever. It is unfortunately showing absolutely zero signs of happening. In fact, because of the rise of the BRICS, something which no creator of EMU could have dreamt of is happening, is that German companies would probably rather be in a monetary union with China by the end of the decade, not France. So, in my opinion, because, of course, one of the real reasons why we have EMU is, in addition to that theory, is the German and French sort of symbiotic closeness about not wanting the mid part of the last decade to ever be repeated. They need to get their act together linked to that pretty quickly. And in my view, if they don't do that within the year after the German election in the autumn of next year, then EMU is going to end up with a much greater risk of it not continuing to exist 10 years from today than I ever would have dreamt. And I regard myself as essentially somebody that is, at heart, was pro-European and still am. But the economic, you have, one of the things I've learned in the real world of business, there's this really annoying thing called evidence that you have to sort of pay attention to. Now against that, however, if they are going to embrace essentially the German view of United States of Europe, it might be more salvable and savable than people think, in my view. Here is, I think, an interesting picture. This is a picture of unit labour costs across a number of countries. Germany is the yellow line at the bottom. And I say it's interesting because you can now see more and more evidence that in the past couple of years there has been notable improvements in some of these very mischievous Club Med countries. And in fact, for Ireland and Portugal, their improvements have been so strong that this measure would appear to suggest they are now more competitive than France. In fact, or the other way of saying that, the place that we should all be worrying about these days is not Spain, Ireland, Portugal, and possibly not even Greece, it should be France. And given the importance of France to the whole project, and going back to what I said a second ago, I think that is quite a big thing to... if we want to worry, that's a big thing to worry about. Last thing to say about it for now, and I apologise, I'm not doing this topic any service whatsoever, but I'm mindful of the time, and I haven't even mentioned anything about the UK yet. I'm going to leave with 2 minutes on the UK. I think this is also quite interesting. This shows you... three different indicators. The third column I won't talk about here, it's the growth environment score I mentioned earlier. It shows you this now for all these developed countries. And ultimately, Another thing European Union supporters have to recognise is you can't really have a lot of countries persistently in a monetary union unless they have things that are consistent in terms of wealth levels and productivity levels. And Greece's GES score is lower than that of Brazil and China, and yet it's in a monetary union with countries like the Netherlands that have some of the best GES scores out of the 180 countries we monitor. And that is the reality of the complexity and difficulty in it that they've created themselves by putting these 17 countries in. But my point really is not that one. If you look at the first column, which is the so-called cyclically adjusted budget deficit, for those of you, again, not trained in the voodoo science, what that means is adjusting the actual fiscal position for whether the economy is weaker than its trend or stronger than its trend. And in the weird world of macroeconomics, it's a more accurate reflection of the true stance of fiscal policy. And interestingly, what you can see is that if you could see it, the underlying bit for the Eurozone as a whole, Europe's situation is troubling in some countries, but not that many anymore, because they've done so much to deal with the problem. But it's not as bad as the rest of most of the rest of the developed world. And one of the reasons why markets are right to be a bit worried about this fiscal cliff in the US is whatever the hell they end up cobbling together as an agreement, they are nowhere near the underlying position that Europe is now moving to. And one of the few things I've learned in 31 years of finance is that usually democratic countries in particular, and maybe others, don't deal with their big sovereign fiscal challenges unless the markets force them to do, and sort of never let a crisis go to waste. So I look forward to the next crisis reappearing in the US, which probably is going to have something to do with this at some point in time. So, finish off with a couple of things about our own wonderful country. So, I must start by saying that I mentioned before that we didn't used to trust Chinese data. I love to make the joke, if you think the Chinese GDP data is bad, try paying a lot of attention to ours. God knows what they did with the ONS, or the Office of National Statistics, when they moved it down to Swansea, but some of that Welsh beer or the Welsh air. But the UK GDP data has the distinction of being the most dramatically revised of any OECD country. And I'm not joking. So there is a reoccurring regular habit, which I'm no great, as I also discussed with people earlier, anybody who was around the University of Surrey with me when I was doing my PhD would know I was far from a very great statistician. I was a pretty pathetic one. But I think I know enough these days that if a trend is so persistent, you should sort of build that into your estimating model. And somehow they don't. But within 2 years, there is over the past 20 years, an average of somewhere around a 0.7% upward revision to the first estimates of UK GDP. For many, many years, we have used what you can see here, which is a so-called composite purchasing managers index. It's each month for the construction industry, the service industry, and the manufacturing industry, purchasing managers indices are published here. The UK research guys that used to work for me, they still do it, I've moved my job, have compiled this combination of the three that we think actually is a true reflection of what's going on with UK GDP. So what it shows you, it's not particularly a great story, but what it does suggest is that the economy did start to make quite a strong recovery initially from the crisis, sort of V-shaped recovery, which is typically the case. But rather worryingly, as you can see, even though it's not as the level of growth has not been as bad as the GDP data suggests, actually the economy is really struggling to stay alive. And that is amongst the hundreds of challenges that our dear friend Super Mark Carney is going to have to think about, as he, according to the media, he is going to now be of such a wonderful capability that any problem we have ever had and any problem we have in the future, Mark is going to solve it. I think there's another relatively simple set of reasons, and the first of which is if you are so driven to tighten fiscal policy for as long as this government is still seemingly planning to do, at the same time as forcing your big banks to delever, so two very powerful forces at the same time, it is hardly surprising that the domestic economy is not all guns blazing. And then if you add in the third thing, is that we can't export like the Germans. Why is it such a mystery? And in order for the UK to do better and to share in some of this remarkable growth that's going on elsewhere in the world, one of those three things, or if not aspects of all three, is going to have to change. Which I'll finish with that, because as demonstrated, in my opinion, by the most spectacularly beautiful Olympic Games we hosted this summer, if we really sort of try to concentrate on what edges the UK does have to offer the world, which includes, in my opinion, education, we could probably do a better job of it rather than kidding ourselves that we're going to be able to out-manufacture the Germans, who have been rather good at this for many, many decades. But we shall see. So, David, I shall stop there, and thank you very much, and apologies for speaking longer than I planned, but I think I've left some time for some questions. Thank you very much.
You kind of said that you feel that lots of economists treat economics excessively as a science. If you could theoretically design a macroeconomics Jim O'Neill course at University of Surrey, what do you think are the methods, tools and concepts that you think are emerging, becoming more relevant in the industry? And that sort of thing. I mean,
you did, Chris, you didn't tell me I was going to get tough questions.
Because I kind of felt the same, because I'm studying economics now, I kind of feel it's a bit too... I like...
You're studying, not...
So. Yeah.
Teachers, lecturers, can you hear this?
I like the relationship between psychology and economics, and I kind of feel that, they kind of treat it a bit too mathematical, but I'd like to hear your opinion on what you think are the key stuff.
So I reflect back, in my day here, which was 1979 to 1982, when one wanted to do an econometric estimate, you had to get a hold of a punch card and then rush to, I think if I remember rightly, it was located just over the back there to the only mainframe computer on the whole campus, and sort of pray to God that it would work overnight, and it was 50-50 odds as to whether you got it the following day. And that taught me the limits of econometrics in the world of economics. And so I guess I'd have two things at the core of that, you've given me an idea for my future. Maybe I should have to design a Jim O'Neill economics course. I would say two things. One is to spend a lot more time on some of the assumptions about rational behaviour that are inherent in so many parts of economics. So just so that people realise they are strong assumptions and are frequently, as we have seen in the past few years, if not decades, not actually backed up by what goes on. And the second thing would be to force everybody to watch videos of Alex Ferguson for the past 26 years. But that would be at the core of it, probably.
I've got a question actually regarding to your current job as head of GSAM.
Yeah.
A lot of people seem to think that we're in a situation right now in financial markets where you've got high correlations that didn't previously exist between lots of different asset classes.
Yeah.
Some people speculate, they think, things move in and out of this high correlation, low correlation phase between them. But what some people think it means is that there's no diversification left in the markets.
Yeah.
How do you approach that at GSAM?
I like how you call it GSAM. We call it GSAM, but I quite like it. It sounds like a TV station, GSAM. So let me come to this picture to answer that. And again, I apologise, especially the questioner. I'm sure you cannot see much of this at all, but helps me set the framework. So I persuaded myself many years ago that at the core of thinking long term about markets, particularly equities, is something called the equity risk premium, which is the return that equities give over the supposed risk-free rate, pending how all these things are calculated. And that's sort of what you see here. And your question is indeed the belief of the masses of finance, and very interesting. And this whole sort of risk on, risk off, everything correlates together, is in the mindset of many, many people. But let me say a few things about it. First of all, what this complicated looking mess is designed to show is that if you think in a truly global sense, as opposed to some sort of Western jaundiced view of it, and use world growth as a proxy for sustainable earnings, which is itself obviously questionable, but I've never found a better alternative, and then go through the kind of simple calculations how one would create an equity risk premium and what implied nominal returns that gives, it shows you that nominal returns, and this is sort of, let's say, thinking for the decade, just below 10% is a reasonable view of earnings, of returns, that people should think. But you link to what you said, you will read many, many people, including very well recognized names, Lewis Bacon, one of the most successful macro hedge fund investors. Lewis, along with others, I think, are thinking with a very US-centric or European-centric view of the world. Because you can get returns of close to 10%. This year, and linked very much to my day job at GSAM, we have, despite what I said earlier, about 18 months ago launched an N11 equity fund. And year to date, I haven't seen it for a couple of days, but it's up about 19%. And there is very little correlation between how that performs on a day-to-day or week-to-week basis with what goes on in the S&P. And it might have something to do with the fact that those markets are generally relatively small, so they don't get sucked into the herd mentality of many technology-induced investor behavior styles. But second thing I would say in that context, I think it's we also have our own macro hedge fund, which, by the way, anybody got a bit of spare cash or the university bursary, as of last night, that is up 22% year to date, and by luck they are the two GSAM funds that I happen to have some of my own money in, so I'm rather lucky in that sense, and I mean that in seriousness. But there is this mentality around them. I also yesterday morning attended the 60th birthday anniversary of the first ever sovereign wealth fund, the Kuwait Investment Office. 60 years has passed since that was started. And I found myself in this context reflecting on the fact that we are in a wonderful environment for those very few investors that can think genuinely long term, because this sort of herd-like mentality, which is partly induced by, again, too much computing and technology, where everybody can measure the minute-to-minute correlation. The consequence of it is people lose sight of the wood for the trees.
because these things, you go through these phases where these correlations appear to be so stable, and they then change dramatically. And the smart investors are the ones that have the mind and the ability and maybe the regulatory support to not get sucked into how everybody else is behaving. And the final thing to say about it, nobody ever said investing was easy. And one of the things that I find, and certainly after 31 years of being in it, it certainly isn't the case, otherwise I'd be sitting on my own Caribbean island and not still working. But one of the other things I've learned linked to that is you've got to be really careful of what the masses think, including especially in investing. And I kind of think for those that really do think globally and a bit out of the box and have the ability to think long term, it's rather good that people talk about this risk on, risk off, and everything correlates, because that means that's a sign that many people are sort of so sucked into that world, they're not going to be very good investors.
Thank you very much. You specifically identified France as an interesting case for treatment, perhaps in the future. It's a country which is notoriously resistant to change. Yeah. We see this in many ways through the CAP and others. We are seeing, I think, some of the younger professional shakers and movers tending to leave the country, coming to London, for example, something the French never did. What do you see as the future for France?
I think it's an exceptionally interesting point you make, and they got to really get all those elite from the Ecole together in one big room and spend a few hours, or if not days, with a locked door, and think back over the past 50 years, because there are at least two huge dilemmas. One of which, linked to what you've said, the French have sort of believed that all these changes that all the smaller Mediterranean countries would have to do was something that they could just stand away from and, you know, pretend to be all sort of supportive but make sure nobody observed too closely. That they had some of the same dilemmas. And the problem for them is of course, helped by not least The Economist magazine 2 weeks ago, 14 pages on it, everybody is aware, in particular, and of great importance, their friends in Frankfurt and Berlin. And I don't see beating up on Lakshmi Mittal is going to be the way that they're going to solve that problem. And the second thing, which in some ways is even bigger, which it sounds like you are obviously personally highly aware of, there is an angle of thought that sort of believes, at the end of the day, what EMU was all about was some French creation to take control of the Bundesbank and stop Germany running European economic policy. And I have some sympathy for that notion, but 12 years on after EMU started, guess what? Didn't work. And I believe, rightly or wrongly, the elite of Germany always were, and even more are now, pretty coordinated and strongly committed to some notion of a United States of Europe, which means they are more than happy to give up aspects of their sovereignty, and their own past, of course, explains why they're not so bothered about that. But the French never dreamt it would get to this kind of stage, even though they had the Germans telling them that before EMU started. And that is an even bigger dilemma that they've got to get their minds through than the competitive one, because it links to what I tried to say briefly earlier. I think a lot of what's going on about European policy making at the moment is the Germans sort of kicking the can down the road until after the election, and they're going to come out of that election with a pretty clear view of, okay, this is the way forward for the euro and the United States of Europe. Sign up or it's all over. And The French are nowhere near buying into that. I don't know what is going to need to change other than them all being shoved in a room and the key being thrown away.
Following on from your analysis of the French scenario, do you think there's a case for the Eurozone to be split into two tiers? Because you've got the net contributors and the net receivers, and we always hear about the net receivers these days. Do you think there's a case for such a split? And like, you know, having their own parameters, each governing the separate tier?
No. If you really follow, I should have said this earlier. If you really follow the criteria which governed the so-called Maastricht criteria, and if you really applied it right now, EMU would exist of Finland and Slovakia. even Germany doesn't qualify specifically because of the debt criteria. But I'm amazed when I see people like as experienced and as successful and deep thinkers as George Soros writing things like that. This idea that Germany should leave the euro, or we should have a sued euro and a Nord euro. It's all nonsense, in my opinion. The only purpose of the Dutch and some of the others will always have a currency link to Germany, whether there was a euro or not. But going back to the previous issue, in my opinion, the reason why we have the euro is to tie Germany and France together at the core of it, and has been the case because of what happened between 1939 and 1945. You can't, if Germany left, that's the end of the euro. And the notion of having two separate euros, I think, is just fanciful, and it's kind of odd. I don't know why. I sometimes wonder whether one of the motives for people like Soros to write such things is because he has a position on it that is.
Just briefly, do you think a case for Germany just getting fed up with it all and just saying?
Well, I think one shouldn't underestimate. Actually, I want to, given where I am, I said I was going to do this, so I want to take an extra minute to demonstrate how much I learned from my PhD, but I'll come back to that in a second. I don't think one should underestimate the desire and belief of the German elite for a life of the euro. Earlier this year, I happened to, by coincidence, travel to three different Eastern European countries that I have not experienced that much of before: Poland, Czech Republic, and Slovakia. And it's fascinating listening to their leading thinkers, because they just presume that the German style and plan for European Monetary Union is going to happen, and with it, policymakers in those countries, from what I experience, are currently assuming and planning that they are going to join this future euro, which is fascinating to hear. And of course, given their own history and relationship with Germany, it's quite interesting. But going back to what I said earlier, I think Germany is going to come out of its election with a pretty strong, clear view of how it, and we see clear signs of it already. And I think, in particular, if the French aren't prepared to give up on some of their sovereign desires, then they might just say, you know what? Guess what, guys? It was a mistake. Let's go and join a monetary union with China. Can I just finish with 2 minutes about this? Sorry, I apologise for if I'm disturbing, interrupting various plans. So I often say to people, when I did my PhD was. Had a wonderful title: An Empirical Investigation into the OPEC Surplus and Its Disposal. And the title was more brilliant than the content. But one of the things I learned from that was never try and forecast oil prices. Here's a picture of what's been going on in oil prices. And right now in the markets is something that I actually really did learn during my PhD. What you see here in yellow is the spot Brent oil price, and in red is the 5-year forward price.
And the blue line is a simple moving average of the red line. And what it shows, broadly, is for the past decade, the five-year price and the spot price move like a hand in a glove. They move together, which, broadly speaking, to me, was confirmation of a rising trend in the equilibrium price of oil. Very interestingly, in the past 2 years, they've moved in different directions. And that leads me to the conclusion, seriously, influenced by all those staggering number of hours locked away in a room on my own trying to figure out aspects of this 30 years ago, that the so-called long-term elasticity of supply and demand have started to kick in because of these high oil prices. And we're in the early days of the dynamics of the energy market changing dramatically, with shale gas and shale oil in the US being a particularly clear example. One of the most interesting anecdotes I've seen this year was a FT story about the US having seen a 21% rise in its coal exports to the rest of the world. The idea that the US would ever be exporting coal again, but the reason why that appears to be the case is because domestic coal prices have fallen a lot, probably linked to this. So I did learn something from my PhD. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jim. We're coming to a part of the program that, so I'll use a French term, raison d'etre of the evening. I'd like to welcome now someone who for us is a very special guest. Sophie Guillaume began her studies in the School of Economics in October this year and is the first student to receive the Jim O'Neill Scholarship. So tonight is the inaugural event of the Jim O'Neill Scholarship. The scholarship is very kindly funded personally by Jim and is a reflection of his commitment to education and his belief that economically disadvantaged students, right, and not coming from a wealthy family should not be a barrier to learning. The scholarship is awarded to exceptional students and will give Sophie financial support throughout her undergraduate studies. I think it's worth noting that Sophie not only shares a love of economics with Jim, but also a love of football.
Oh, yeah. Not a Liverpool fan, I hope.
No. Well, it's okay. Right? She played women's under 19 football for England, and is a Chelsea supporter, however.
That's all right.
Sophie, if you could please come up.
Wow. There you go. Congratulations. Well done. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, everyone, for coming to the event. Thank you to Jim again, and we hope to see you back here soon. Thanks very much.
Thank you.